y'all. We are so excited to start a new series on our YouTube channel. First of all, thank you so much for all of your love on our empty house tour. We never thought it would get that many views. We were just super excited. We had just closed our house, and yes, we do know the video is very overexposed, but we were just so excited. It didn't matter. Through that video, and then also on my Instagram channel and my blog, we have gotten a ton of home building questions. So we wanted to break some things down for you because we knew absolutely nothing when
we started at zero for us. Especially, yeah. We didn't even plan to do a new build until we searched around the market and realized that was probably the best option for us in our price range.
We're gonna tackle the design center first, just because I feel like people want to know about the pretty stuff. And honestly, this was such a mystery to us, and we're very excited to be able to like pull the curtain back a little bit, share what we learned, what we know, and hopefully prevent you guys from making a few of the same mistakes we made, or just to save you a little bit of stress, because this was the most stressful part for all of us.
The learning curve is steep. It can be steep, and you probably are doing this once, and maybe if you're lucky, twice in your life.
So learn from us, and if you have any questions, please feel free to ask them in the comments below, and we're gonna get started. And the first thing I wanna say is you need to have a game plan. This is not the time to be laissez-faire and hands-off.
Yeah, so for our, you know, this video is focused on the design center, but before we came into it, we said, you know, we need our house to face a certain way for weather purposes, for heat purposes. We
need to
be very close to the highway. That's for logistics purposes. And then just for us and the design wise, we said, you know, the filter is, do they offer the options we want for painted brick? Do they offer some customizations that we would need internally so that we would just have our dream house?
Definitely, before you go to sign your contract, if you can, I highly recommend taking a visit down to the design center. That way you get a good idea of how much things cost, right? Because a lot of us, when we're looking for a home, especially for us, we know what we want to spend, and then we look for homes in that range. But the last thing you want to do is buy a house that's right there, and then you go to the design center, and the next thing you know, you're 100K over budget because you know things don't come standard. You want nice things, and that's just not included. So if you can, it's super easy. Just call and ask. It never hurts to ask, and then try to make a case for it. Hey, I want to go in and see what's standard. I just want to have an idea of how much things cost, you know? And something we felt like really helped us get an appointment was just saying, we don't need a full-blown appointment. We just kind of want someone to show us around, maybe an hour, maybe two, and we just want to get an idea of what you have and how much things cost. And I made a lot of mental notes. It took some on my phone as well. Once we figured out what kind of levels we wanted, and you'll notice that we speak in levels because
there's a new language when you're buying a custom home. And so, you know, they speak in levels, not dollars and cents. Like, you go to the Texas State Fair, they speak in tickets and not dollars. So you'll learn there's Builder Basic, doesn't have a level, just comes with your house. And then you get to level one and all the way up to eight for us, which is the nicest stuff they have. And whether it's the floor, the wall, the doors, not everything goes to level eight, for example. Some things just stop at level five or level six.
Yeah, but that way you get an idea, and also to ask for what's standard. And you know, don't be a snob, you never know. For us, we found a lot of options that were standard. We actually really liked better than the items that were more expensive, so it doesn't hurt to ask. And then when people ask about price ranges, you know, I would say the average person spends about 10% of their base price on upgrades. So just factor that in. Everyone's gonna be different. Someone might spend less, some might spend more. We kind of hit right about at 10%. We were just a little bit more, but we stayed on our budget, and I think that's what was stressful for us, but we knew we didn't wanna go broke, that's for sure.
Yeah, two things to keep in mind. One is when you go to either the open house or the model house, is this is not what you're gonna get for the base price. So when you see the prices of the house you wanna custom build, add in the 10%. If they have any credits, or if they don't, ask for them if they offer them, because that'll save you a bunch, and they're changing all the time. So just make sure to ask, and make sure to add it to your budget.
So the next thing I would say that was really important for us was to have a mood board, and We actually were able to work with an interior designer. We weren't full-fledged clients or anything like that, but it was just so helpful to have someone to bounce ideas off of and to help us make some decisions. Again, we knew absolutely nothing. We did a lot of Google University, and it was really nice to have someone share their expertise, you know, help us pick and tell us, you know, hey, that's a fair price for that. That is not a fair price. That's something we can do after. So have a mood board. You can show that to either an interior designer or actually the design center rep. They have interior design experience and they can help you make good decisions for your home as well. But you're gonna need to have something to share with them. So go on Pinterest, go on Instagram. Just make sure you have it all kind of in one spot so that they can look at it and see big picture. Hey, this person really wants, you know, a moody kitchen, or hey, this person really wants an airy bathroom. If you have something in your head, but there isn't a way to visualize that, that design center rep is not gonna be able to help you the best way they can because they can't see inside your brain.
They say a picture is 1,000 words, and if you have a Pinterest or mood board that's 10 to 20 photos, that should actually be enough. Like, you can convey your design style and kind of your energy just from 20 photos. So don't think you need to create a mountain of these images.
If anything, something pared down is probably better because you don't want to get carried away. And I mean, for example, something that's kind of easy is, say you pin 10 different kitchens, right? And there's always gonna be one thing usually that's consistent through those 10 pictures. The design center rep can look at that and be like, okay, that's what they're going for, and be able to bring that to life for you. Hopefully it's in your budget. Or if not, they can find ways to supplement it. Speaking of things that are must-haves, let's share ours. Mm-hmm. And they were kind of big ticket items, and that's why we kind of call them must-haves. So we start with our budget, we factor those in, and then we play around with what's
everything
left over.
Else, yeah. For me, the metaphor is always, you have a jar and you need to fill it with big rocks, pebbles, and sand. And so the big rocks, the things that are the most important for us were like our kitchen island, our master bathroom. And then the pebbles were like, actually, another one was our paint and trim. Those things were non-negotiable. When we talked to and reviewed builders and we talked to the design centers, we said, hey, can you do this? If you don't offer this, we'll just kind of keep looking.
Yeah, and another thing I do want to add to that is sometimes a builder can't do painted brick, and you know, that's fine. You can get that done after, but the next question should be, does the HOA allow it, the homeowners association? You know, most I would say do allow it, but you never know nowadays, and I would hate for y'all to buy a house thinking you can paint it, and then that's not the case. So just ask around, and also keep in mind, if you can get into a new development early, or you're in your phase early, that's most likely better because you have free range of options, right? Nowadays, a lot of builders can get picky with making sure, you know, these three houses don't look exactly alike on the same street. So we were kind of first in our area. So when we went to the design center, she was like, do whatever y'all want. You're the first house on that street, pick whatever.
Yeah.
But I know from friends, like, they've had to go back and change their color scheme, or they've had to change their stone or their brick because another house, you know, three houses down has that look. So there's just things to keep in mind when you're looking, and your sales rep should be able to help you with that and like give you other options. But our must-haves did cost quite a bit.
Our must-haves probably cost us 30 to 50% of our extra budget. They were
our waterfall island, which we mentioned earlier, and in the spirit of full disclosure, it was a 5-digit item, right, as far as pricing. So for us, if we were paying for a waterfall island, and that includes, you know, you have to pay for the top piece of the counter and then the two side pieces, right? Like at first we thought, oh, that's the whole thing.
Two islands, basically.
You're paying for two islands. Once we figured out we wanted that, we thought, hey, it's probably, we'll get more bang for our buck if we just get the waterfall with a higher level stone. It just made more sense and it just gives you more impact. So we went for a level 6 quartz. We're super excited about it. We were here the day of the install because we are those homeowners.
You wanna tell them about the sink and why
we
chose that too?
So this kind of factors in, but I've always wanted an apron front sink. I joke it's probably like the only farmhouse thing in our house. But our interior designer, she was saying how with the sink and the countertops, you do them together or you don't do them at all, because it is impossible to change out the sink without damaging the countertops or vice versa, especially with the sink we wanted. So we went ahead, we got the farmhouse apron front sink, We got the waterfall island, and we were here because they had to cut out our island for our sink, and we wanted that extra piece because we paid for it.
Yeah, and then another cut, actually semi-custom, there are two other custom pieces in our kitchen, including the cover for our vent hood, which we had to upgrade for the look we wanted. That's on her, I'm the waterfall island guy. And then we had a custom appliance garage get created just so we could keep our appliances hidden away, clean and proper.
Yes, so we just have, you know, rice cooker, sous vide, air fryer, etc. And these are just really bulky items and they're just not cute. You know, this is not a massive house contrary to what you may see on Instagram or through my empty house tour. We don't have this crazy big pantry, right? So some houses have a separate kitchen where you can stow that stuff away. We do not, and I did not want to see these items, so we had them custom build this for us, and it cost us a pretty penny, but I feel like overall it was absolutely worth it. We love it, and it makes our life functionally better.
On the note of custom pieces, this came out from a Pinterest mood board. You know, sometimes you have 20 photos, you have an idea of generally what you want, but we had some Pinterest photos that were like, this is exactly what I want. So we also had custom open shelving. We removed some of the cabinets that come standard and said, hey, we want three floating shelves. That was custom. So most of our custom items came in our kitchen, and that was, I mean, outside of removing, changing the fence, that was it.
Yeah, that was it. And I think something else to keep in mind, our construction manager actually mentioned this to us, is, you know, most builders cannot do Pinterest perfect, right? Unless you are rebuilding that exact house on that exact lot facing that exact direction, it's never gonna look exactly the same. So it's important to keep in mind, you know, they're gonna try their absolute best to make it as close as possible, but sometimes it just cannot be perfect. But your design center rep can probably find you similar tile, similar look. They'll help you navigate that process. But those were our must-haves, and to be honest, once we factored those into our price, the rest, we were like, okay, we need to cut this so we can get this island. We need to cut this so we can get these cabinets.
So an example was, when we came into the process, I wanted like a nice decorative fireplace, because we had, in our great room, there's a lot of height. But when we said, you know, it's either the waterfall island or the fireplace covering, we just said, you know, our fireplace finishing was just a smooth stucco-ish wall,
yeah.
And it was $200.
Actually, $125.
It was so cheap.
It was very economical.
So once we filled in our biggest priorities, we said, you know, flooring here can be basic, our carpet's basic, our laundry room is basic, builder basic, and then we kind of filled in little things like our doors have unique designs.
Yeah, and so speaking of our doors, we can go into that as far as upgrades that we felt were worth it, right? So obviously all of our must-haves we felt were worth it because they were our must-haves, but the doors, and you know, this is something that you won't really see on my Instagram, my blog, or my YouTube channel a ton because no one really just does a full-blown video on doors.
Share our new front door. This has been a long time coming.
But they have made the biggest impact in our home. So our home, we wanted it to be, it's what we call transitional style. It's the design term for it. It's where we have a classic home, but we want more modern finishes.
It's a touch of modern.
Yeah, and so with the waterfall island and all these other things that were clean and more minimalist, our design center rep actually brought this up to us and she said, hey, I think you should upgrade your doors. So I'll put a photo here of what a typical standard door looks like. We got lucky in that all of our doors are 8 feet, that came standard with our builder. Thank goodness, because we have about 10-foot ceilings in most places. And so to get this classic door with our house, especially with our baseboards, which are just literally flat, there's no decorative molding or anything, it just felt very off. And it made such a big difference to upgrade to a single shaker style panel door. And I'll let Johnny explain in the master bedroom how much of a difference this made, because it took one big project completely off of our hands.
So we were planning to actually change out the doors. We have two kind of panel doors that go into our master bathroom. And we were like, you know, when we first looked at the open house or the model home, we said, you know, we're gonna rip it out, we're gonna throw in a farmhouse door or something. But once they put in the doors, all the single panel doors throughout the house, as well as that one, we said, I think we're good, actually.
Yeah.
So you'll find throughout the process, whether it's at the design center or during the build, that you can be surprised a lot of times with how good things end up being.
Yeah. Another place where we found really good value was in our floors. And this is actually where our interior designer came in really handy and saved us a lot of money. We were torn between two different hardwood floors. One was a level 3, which was much more economical, and one was a level 6 or level 5. And I mean, if we went with that, we would have had to cut a lot of things. And we didn't even show her the price, you know, just aesthetic only. I texted her photos and she chose the cheaper one.
I mean, our intuition was we wanted the higher level.
But we were biased, right? Because we were like, oh, it's level 6, it must be nicer. Mm-hmm. But
yeah, so you can see the floors here. No, but she chose them because they had a nice gray tone and it actually fit our style better.
They look much more natural. It's not as cookie cutter, I guess is what you would say. The other ones definitely looked very perfect and symmetric, and we like that these are a little bit more organic. I'm trying to think of what else we thought was really worth it. Oh, our bathroom.
Yes.
The tile.
So in our master bathroom and also throughout the house, what you'll find is we upgrade everything to go all the way to the ceiling. So the theme of the house is it's small but mighty. So our cabinets go up, and then the tiling in our master bathroom goes all the way up. And then in the middle of the process, we changed from a long vertical subway tile, and we actually chose to horizontal subway tile, and then we were gonna change it to a herringbone throughout the process because we said, you know, we're spending a lot and a herringbone's gonna be more unique.
And it's actually the same tile we have as our kitchen backsplash, and so we just wanted a way to spice it up and make it a little bit different but still keep things cohesive. And speaking of all the way up, right, it was one of those things where, you know, we were paying for this expensive tile. We were gonna do it on a pattern brick back then, and so we thought, would it make sense to cut it off at the standard, I think, like 8 feet height. It just felt weird. So we wanted to bring it all the way up, and it essentially cost us the same amount to get it in the first place for those extra few feet, but it makes such a big difference. And it's one of those things where, you know, you go big or you go home. Our bathroom definitely wouldn't have had the impact we wanted if we didn't take it all the way up, and it is absolutely worth it. Sometimes you just have to weigh it, right? With our waterfall island, same thing. You know, we just felt like it wouldn't have been a big impact if we chose a lower grade stone.
Right. Yeah, we have the smallest house technically, right? Mm-hmm. So I would say that for us, it was all about making it, you know, it's one of the biggest investments in your life. So we wanted to invest in the items in our home. And one of the features is the doors are tall, the ceiling is tall. And so we wanted to accentuate that by bringing the tile all the way up, our cabinets all the way up, so that even though the space itself isn't like a huge space, it feels bigger than it is.
Yeah, so it's just really important to keep all of these things in mind, as well as resale value. You know, we did the kitchen and the bathroom because those things sell homes. So, you know, if there's ever a situation where we need to sell this home, it has that value in it, and it's something a potential buyer would be interested in. So we did go over budget a tiny little bit. I think we hit around 10%. Give a little bit, but we stayed on budget. It took a lot, but it's absolutely possible. You just really have to know your priorities, and that's why we say having those must-haves up front is key.
One tidbit, as she looks, is
at our notes.
Yeah, so one tidbit is when you go to your design meetings, we got two meetings. The first one, they will lay out everything. So you give them your mood board, they lay out all the nicest things, and then by the second meeting, your job is to start redlining, saying, this but not that, this but not that. And we stayed up long nights just saying, oh, I really want this so bad. But you realize what's important. You know, this is your investment. You can make long-term decisions and say, you know, I don't need something, or I absolutely need it.
Yeah, so you really just have to decide. But speaking of upgrades, you know, there were a lot of things we chose to upgrade ourselves to save money, and oh my gosh, we were able to save a lot of money by installing all of our cabinet hardware ourselves.
Yes, we bought all the handles, all the knobs. We got our power drill, and the second day we moved in, we just spent basically the first weekend just drilling holes, installing them, and it would have cost us several thousand dollars.
Yeah, easily. Every builder is different, but when we looked at their hardware options, we didn't really like them, and then on top of that, they charge a fee to install every single one. So when you think about that, we said we would rather take that money and get a really high quality pull, just because when you think about how many times you open a drawer or open a cabinet, multiply that by how many people are in your home. We wanted something that was high quality. And so we just watched a few YouTube videos, and then after our experience, we wrote a blog post. So that's on my blog, I'll link it down below. It wasn't bad, and we've actually helped other friends do it, so.
Yeah, and then the second thing were some other finishing items, like our sink. We said, you know, we'll get builder basic sink finishes, fixtures, and we'll just get it separately. So we found a great deal on the Dream faucet.
Yeah.
I installed it, and then second to that, we also installed our light fixtures, which can cost you a pretty penny because they're charging you not just an upsell on the light fixture itself, but also the installation. If you learn to do it yourself, you will save a lot on these items.
Yeah, and I think something that's really important is a lot of people have DM'd me on Instagram and said, oh my gosh, you guys are so handy. And like, yes, but at the same time, like, we're complete newbies. We didn't know how to do any of this stuff.
I didn't own tools really before this house. I owned like one toolkit, and we figured out how to do all these things.
Yeah, we just watched some YouTube videos. We were willing to learn, make some mistakes, figure it out. And I think if you have a good attitude about it, and to be honest, it's so nice to be able to say like, hey, we did this. We have this crazy sense of satisfaction. You know, we installed these lights in our own, and they look great.
Yeah, and you'll realize, once you YouTube, even the electricians are like, I don't know why people hire me. It's like two wires. Make sure to turn off your breaker.
Yeah, super, super important. All right, so some other things that we plan on doing is, we did upgrade our laundry room to get plumbing for a sink, but we didn't have the money to put in that sink or cabinetry or to do the laundry room we both knew we wanted. So we just got builder basic everything.
Yeah, builder basic laundry, builder basic closet, builder basic
carpet,
guest room,
carpet,
builder basic second bedroom. And because for us, those are opportunities. Those are opportunities for us to personalize those rooms, whether they're an office, nursery, a guest bedroom. We want to give them we want to put our fingerprints on this home.
Yeah. All right, so speaking of design limitations, a couple of people were asking what we were able to do and what we weren't. So again, every builder is going to be different, and we aren't necessarily going to be sharing our builder just for privacy reasons, but if you're looking to build in the Dallas area, just send me an email, and I'm more than happy to send you recommendations, because when we were looking,
so many.
We, for 6 months, we would take what we called like road trips on the weekends where we would pack a snack and some meals and we would hit the road and go see all of these builders. You know, sometimes a house we wanted to see, even though the neighborhood was in Dallas, the actual house was in another city, and we would have to drive like 2 hours to go see this house. So we've seen so many. So if we can help you guys find a builder, just send me an email with your price point, your criteria, and we'll send you guys in the right direction. But for our builder and our floor plan, we could not move walls, right? Trust me, I literally begged for a powder bathroom, right? Like, this home isn't absolutely perfect, but it's one that we absolutely love. If I could have gotten a powder bathroom, I think I would have been happy, but that was not happening. But what happened? We were able to change out the cabinets, like Johnny said earlier, add in the custom appliance garage. So just be upfront with your builder about what you can do, and don't be afraid to ask questions. Everything else for us, as far as design, was fair game.
Easy.
All right. So also, when you're at the design center, it's super cool to see all this beautiful marble and all this like pretty paint colors, etc. But you also have to think about living with it, right? So for me, I know a lot of people say like, oh my gosh, white countertops. Like, how do you keep that clean? To be honest, I've lived in apartments where the counters were dark and they were dirty because I couldn't see the dirt, right? So I know that sounds gross and like my skin's crawling thinking about it, but when we have white counters like this and I see a stain, like, I can't leave it alone. Like, I clean it right away. So you have to think about how you're living with it, right? Something else, a lot of people asked why we didn't go with marble. One, we couldn't afford it, so we'll just say that. Two, it's very porous. You know, we, in Asian cooking, we use a lot of chili oil.
Chili oil, lots of things that stain.
Yeah.
Turmeric stains almost everything.
So, you know, getting marble just wasn't an option, and these are things you have to think about. How are you gonna live in this home? So keep that in mind. Sometimes the option you really wanna go with may actually end up taking up more of your time and making you unhappy in the long run. All right, random questions. How much did we know before?
Absolutely nothing.
Nothing. We learned all of this through Google University.
Googling, asking friends, which we don't have that many that were in this process, so we're happy to be sharing with them and you all our lessons.
Yeah. All right, so if we had to cheap out on anything, what would we cheap out on?
For this is actually a good question. So we helped a lot of friends design their houses, and they said, no, I have to have X and Y. And we're like, I don't care about that at all.
Yeah.
For us, we cheaped out on our bedroom. We were like, basic carpet, it's gray, it's multifunctional, and we're gonna lay a carpet over it. We had no extra finishes on any of our accessory rooms. Besides our bathroom.
Yeah.
Bathroom and kitchen and living room it took up everything basically.
Yeah, we were pretty much out of money after that. And for us, you know, something else that is kind of easy to cheap out on, like I said earlier, we just changed all of our lights. We went with what is standard. And you'd be kind of surprised actually when we took out some of the light fixtures, we were like, this is plastic.
I was afraid. They're definitely your finishes from your handles, your light fixtures, and your faucets will cost you a pretty penny. If you can, I honestly am scared, I hate water. I'm more afraid of the water stuff than the electricity. So when I learned to change our first faucet, it made me feel more comfortable with changing anything in the shower, our guest bathroom faucets. It'll save you a lot.
So I think another thing I wanted to point out was in our design center experience, you can't mix collections, say a faucet, right? So we actually were like, hey, we can save money by getting the basic faucets in our master bathroom and then we can swap those out. But then we discovered with our standalone tub, there was no way we could change that fixture. Like
trap.
We would have to take apart the entire tub, which would void the warranty. And at that point, like, I don't even know how you lift the top of the tub off.
I'm not that kind of do-it-yourselfer.
Yeah.
We definitely ran into some projects we tried to show some of our handiest friends and they were like, you should call someone.
Yeah, so for that reason, we decided, you know, we had no choice. We had to upgrade our master faucets, but we left our guest bathroom standard.
You'll be ready for an upgrade soon.
Yeah, so let's see. What regrets do we have?
So you'll learn through the process that everyone's human, and whether it's your building manager or your designer, that things can get lost in communication, or it's good to double check and make sure everything is written in your contract, because they will use it as a checklist and they will give it to you as it's on there. And so we've made some mistakes, like our trim isn't exactly perfect, and we went back and we said, yeah, it should be this paint color. We said this exact thing. The designer
showed us a swatch that was that pink color. Like, I have photos of it. And then for some reason, that color never made it onto the contract. And we were so busy going over other bigger details, like, did you write the correct stone down? All this other stuff. We just trusted her because she showed us a paint swatch and our trim color is wrong.
Slightly, but it's still, those are the kinds of things where you say, everything you discuss needs to be mirrored in the contract that you sign, because their job is to deliver exactly what's in the contract, otherwise they can't close. And so just make sure all your selections are accurate.
Another thing for me that I think is really important is if there is a detail you think is a standard, I guess, just make sure you confirm it, right? So when we were building this house, we were living in an apartment, and granted, like, it was kind of a bit of a luxury apartment, but it was still an apartment. And to me, an apartment is not as nice as a home, especially this home we were building. Our cabinets actually hit flush, right? So if you have two cabinet doors, they touch, even if they open, you know, their own direction away. And so I just assumed when we were building our home that our cabinets would do that because of how much we were paying. Wrong, they do not. And it's kind of sad. Every time I look at our cabinets, sometimes I get a little angry. But it was just one of those things where I asked and they said it wasn't an option, but then I saw it at another house.
This will happen pretty often. Is you have to remember, it's a pretty big company sometimes. They have multiple people and a lot of options to run through.
Yeah.
If you have a question, you may need to ask it to multiple people. So your building manager is building the houses. He's seen a lot of options. Your design manager and has other design reps in the office, you might just ask. And even the sales rep is selling these things, knows and is aware of all the options that are available. So I would actually circulate your question to three people independently.
Thank you so much for tuning in to our Design Center Q&A. If y'all have any questions, make sure you check my blog or the description bar down below. I have a full blog post with all of the details on our kitchen, our home finishes, so like paint colors, what lighting fixtures we went with, our sink, yada yada. All that good stuff is on the blog. If not, feel free to send me an email or leave me a comment down below, and we will try to get back to you.
Please like and subscribe.